I don't know what it is, but I have a newfound respect for Dustin Runnels. The son of a plumber has turned up to work, unpacked his wrestler's bag, removed his makeup bag from his wrestler's bag, put makeup on his face, and then slipped into what can only be described as a torso condom for the best part of the last 23 years. And I don't know how he's lasted so long. I've been stuck in this torso condom for less than a month now, and I already want to shatter my own dreams, whatever that means. Putting Pachiti Dust to one side for a second, as I stand here shining like Harry's tooth in Home Alone 1, I've come to realize that Goldust is one of the most underappreciated wrestlers of all time. He's one of wrestling's great characters. Imagine if an Oscar statue with an unhealthy obsession for movie trivia came to life and was also an ambiguous sexual deviant with strong homosexual undertones. In a time when homosexuality wasn't so widely accepted initially, I should add. And then came out the other side of those torrid times and went on to become one of the shining lights in WWE's often faltering comedy division. That's our Goldie. The Goldust character has gone through a few tweaks over the past two decades, but one thing has remained the same throughout. He's a really strange bastard, and a wonderfully strange bastard at that. I'm Adam Pachiti Dust from Cultaholic.com, and let's celebrate Goldust by looking back at the 10 most bizarre moments from his WWE career. Join us! Number 10, One Foot in the Bog. This is one of the more innocuous moments from Goldust's career, but a moment that still had you screaming, "What on earth are you doing, you silly golden man?" For a reason that is still unknown to this day, Goldust was desperate to be R-Truth's tag team partner in an act of desperation the likes of which we've never seen before. Or since, because R-Truth is rubbish. Goldie would text and call R-Trizzle till the cows came home, harassing the poor bloke at every turn. R-Truth wanted to go for a run. Goldust was there sweating his golden globes off with him. R-Truth wanted to check into a hotel. Goldust was there to take his bags. R-Truth wanted to drop the kids off at the pool. Goldust was there waiting for him, perched on the rim of the toilet like a golden cobra ready to strike at its unassuming prey. I hope to high heavens that WWE were in a brand new arena for this episode of Raw, and that nobody's bowels had bited the bowl of that toilet yet, because Goldust quite literally puts his foot in it. In what was a scripted backstage promo, somebody asked a 46-year-old man to not only dip, but splash his foot around in a toilet, and he did so. Is there nothing that man won't do? Number 9, in bed with Booker T. Back in the 2K2, Goldie found himself on Raw after the first ever WWE draft, in a tag team tandem with Booker T. Try and say that five times, I dare you. This wasn't one of those occasions where WWE throw together two superstars with very little in common and force us to watch them melt in front of our faces. The pair produced a number of hilarious moments, and I'm not being ironic in an R-Truth isn't he fun to watch way either. They were genuinely funny. After a fleeting run, the tag team tandem of suckers came to an end when Booker joined the New World Order. Those bad boys in black didn't allow Goldust to join their club for some reason. Poor Goldust. Goldie wanted his Booker back for good, and did everything but sing Take That's Anthem to try and get him. I mean, everything. Let's set the scene here. What appeared to be a female admirer of Booker's somehow found herself backstage at Judgment Day 2002. During an interview, Booker allowed his, well, cock to take control of his brain and got distracted by the Lady in Black. The Lady in Black wanted something signed somewhere and would give Booker her hotel key in a moment that proved catfishing did indeed exist back in 2002. In the hotel room later that night, Booker was in bed preparing for a game of Sudoku or something. The Lady in Black joined him and requested that the lights be turned off, I assume because she wanted a good night's sleep. After some amateur kissing sound effects, Booker asked the Lady in Black to talk dirty to him, only for Goldust's kinky voice to respond, asking his friend to leave the NWO once more. The lights were turned back on, it was all a ruse, and we got to see Booker T's ass. Everyone was a winner. Number 8. The reason he was released in 2012. Yoshitatsu is a rubbish human being. He was rubbish in the ring during his time with WWE, and later went on to prove he's rubbish out of it while on commentary duty for New Japan Pro Wrestling. Once more, just in case you missed it, Yoshitatsu is rubbish. Back in 2012, and with his in-ring career seemingly winding down, what a weird thing to say in 2018 when he's still donning that fabled torso condom, Goldust was taking on an agent's role backstage for WWE. You know the agents, they're the fellas whose job it is to break up unsolicited brawls that happen each and every week on Raw and SmackDown while shouting, "What are you doing, man? Stop it!" They look like they have so much fun. One of their other duties is to work alongside talent in structuring the matches we see on television each week. One match in particular that Goldie was responsible for shattered his livelihood for a period of time. Rubbish Tatsu, teaming with Ezekiel Jackson, took on Titus O'Neil and Darren Young in a contest that looked to be as inoffensive as a newborn child, on paper. The finish of the match saw Tatsu hoisted up by Titus in a powerbomb position position, allowing Young to leap off the top rope and deliver some kind of reverse doomsday device. Even though he had nothing to do with the execution of the move, which looked like it just about executed poor old Yoshi's head off, Goldust lost his job for having the three superstars do it. It was way too dangerous to be happening on SmackDown. We're forever seeing wrestlers being released for botching a move, but never the producer that put the match together. So it's certainly a bizarre way for a bizarre superstar come producer to do so. Number 7, The Stutter. Man alive, this was a bit insensitive. Back in 2003, Goldie was sat backstage wondering where it had all gone wrong when Randy Orton and Batista asked him where Scott Steiner was. Goldie didn't reply to the two gorgeous stallions, so they beat the bejesus out of him, which was a bit harsh if you ask me. There's a chance that he just didn't hear them. Anyway, the beatdown spilled out into the arena where Goldie was thrown into a wall of electrical things twice, the second time resulting in his Golden Globes being cooked. And by Golden Globes, I mean bollocks. The frying of Goldie saw our favourite weirdo develop a stutter and Tourette-like tics. Which is funny, because funny noises are fun. It was explained that the electrocution had disturbed the mind and speech of Goldust, even though it was very apparent that WWE were dealing with a very sensitive affliction in the most insensitive way imaginable. Let's all laugh at the man with a disability, they said. If you take Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer song and replace Santa's Little Helper with Goldie the Stuttering Wrestler, you've got how that storyline panned out. Goldust would try to speak, he'd make some funny noises, and the entire world would laugh. Shame on you, WWE. Shame on you. Number 6. The time he was chased by OJ Simpson at WrestleMania. You'll never believe this, but there's one piece of the OJ Simpson story the news never told you about. WWE superstar Goldust was chased by OJ's white Ford Bronco while driving a golden Cadillac. I kid you not. WrestleMania 12's Hollywood backlot brawl was a weird one. So, with Razor Ramon suspended for 6 weeks for failing a drugs test, which had absolutely nothing to do with his impending departure to WCW, Roddy Piper was drafted in to take on the Bizarre One, who was very much a top-level heel at the time. Piper hosed down the area where the pair would be battling, and then when Goldie and his little golden car arrived, he soaked that too, presumably so Goldie couldn't do any sick moves off the hood, bro. After making a mess of the catering on the scene, Goldust got in his car and took off, with Piper hopping in a white Bronco in hot pursuit. 2 years earlier, of course, OJ Simpson had his famous low-speed chase in LA in the same vehicle. So 6 months after the OJ verdict, Vince McMahon thought there was still some humor to be wrenched from the whole trial, so decided to use old news footage of the Simpsons chase, hoping fans wouldn't realize one of the biggest news stories of the entire decade was being presented as a wrestling match. The best part is, the announcer had no idea why the footage looked so similar, presumably because they chose to be blind for the 20 months or so prior. After a chase that lasted a large chunk of Mania, Goldie, now bone dry even though he was drenched by Piper not too long before, arrived at the arena to play hide and seek around the backstage area. The car that Piper got into before it was commandeered by OJ Simpson arrived soon after, with Piper stepping out of the driver's seat once more. How? What happened to OJ? We were definitely watching footage of OJ's chase, so where was OJ? Oh my goodness, was Roddy Piper OJ Simpson? Number 5. The lingerie. Sticking with the Mania 12 match, which was put together by people on very strong hallucinogenics apparently, and a finish that will not be leaving your head for a while, so if you haven't seen the conclusion to the Hollywood backlot brawl, strap yourself in because you're in for a disturbingly kinky ride. So after Roddy and Goldie made their way back to the arena and their game of hide and seek through the backstage area came to an end, they were back in the ring with our Goldie's hands going for walks in places they shouldn't. Essentially, this was sexual molestation from both parties taking place before our eyes. But it's wrestling, so... We saw bare chest rubbing, I'm blushing, and then the pièce de résistance saw Piper put a lip lock on our man's painted lips. None of this was bizarre though, it was all so beautiful. Look at Piper grabbing Goldie's hot rod, isn't it so pure? The weirdness came right at the end of the match when Piper stripped off Goldie's torso condom to reveal some lingerie. Goldust is weird, we know that much, but the reason for the women's underwear on the grandest stage of them all was never really explained. He kicked off his WWE run as an androgynous son of a plumber before the heavy implications of homosexuality came into play. Now he was a transvestite. With our Goldie running away under a blanket, Piper unofficially won a match with no referee. It's safe to say, however, that by seeing Goldust wearing women's lingerie, professional wrestling was the real winner. Number 4. The artist formerly known as Goldust. After having the rug completely pulled from under him, a watered-down version of Goldust was floundering. The untimely death of Brian Pillman ended a potentially interesting feud abruptly, where the loose cannon had won Marlena from his foe for 1 month, leading to those Brian Pillman XXX Files vignettes. Ugh. With no new plans forthcoming, an awkward interview took place where Goldust left Marlena claiming that he had someone else. That someone else would turn out to be Luna Vachon. After screwing Team USA at Survivor Series 1997, Jim Ross called Goldust out so he could explain his actions. With a new Goldie coming out complete with fully black makeup, red lipstick, and the letters FU written on his cheeks. This is about to take a very bizarre turn. 1 week later, and Runnels was out in his pajamas with a doctor's note saying he couldn't take the ass whooping Vader was about to give him. Then it was a wheelchair-bound Dustin having alcohol rubbed into his shoulders by a lady who was revealed to be Luna, claiming he was a quadriplegic as a result of a broken arm. Why do we like wrestling? Now the troubled ball was really rolling down the hill. Over the next few weeks, Goldust would appear as a dog on a leash reading Dr. Seuss-like poems, a Christmas tree reading The Night Before Christmas, a giant baby covered in poo after being thrown into a porta-john by Stone Cold Steve Austin, a damn racist complete with blackface and an afro wig, Sable, John Cena, Vader, Triple H, Marilyn Manson, and Dusty Rhodes. This acid trip came to an end soon after, with Dustin Runnels coming onto the Raw stage to announce the death of Goldust before throwing his outfit into a burning trash can. Number 3, grinding on a gravedigger. Back in the day, Mankind would scratch Goldust back, and Goldust would scratch Mankind's, and the pair would try to hurt The Undertaker. While he was hell-bent on defeating the dead man, it was clear to all who was watching the feud that Goldie also had the hots for old coffin breath. This wasn't a case of mind games, this was a case of a fanboy getting into the ring and doing things he dreamt of doing for a very long time. This particular altercation took place on Raw, with Taker declaring that he was going to end Goldust in the midst of some bad movie-based metaphors. Goldust would come out, compliment Taker for being clammy, stiff, his choice in cologne, and claim that if the pair were to get into the big golden casket at ringside, there would be no resting, hinting at plenty of shagging because he'd try anything once. Goldie would then feel Taker's arms and lock hands, only for that spoilsport to turn a moment of passion into a test of strength. Mankind came out to save Goldie's bacon, using the mandible claw to do so. With The Undertaker passed out in the center of the ring, Goldust took off his robe and grinded on him. He saw a man passed out and sexually assaulted him. Goldust was a bad man back then. All the credit in the world has to go to Taker here, because I would have been giggling like a small child. And speaking of small childs, we were leaving the cartoon era of WWE here, meaning that presumably more children than normal would have been watching the show. Just imagine little Jimmy sitting down with his parents to watch Raw and seeing that. He'd be confused. His parents would be appalled. Nobody would know what to do with themselves. Fantastic. Number 2, mouth to mouth on Ahmed Johnson. This moment being so close to the top of the list is all about context. WWE broke down walls and pushed boundaries with Goldust, the likes of which weren't being seen in too many other areas of entertainment at the time. Goldust liked to kiss. Who doesn't like to kiss? Goldust was kissing men on television in a time when men kissing men on television wasn't as widely accepted as it is today. One of the times Goldust planted a lip lock on another man was the time he administered CPR on Ahmed Johnson, after the Pearl River Powerhouse was knocked out by Owen Hart on Raw. Earlier in the night, and while Goldust was trying to run away from the Ultimate Warrior, because who wouldn't, Johnson chased him back to the ring. After Goldie and Warrior were both counted out, the Bizarre One waited around backstage, rushing to Johnson's aid when he was in the process of being wheeled out of the arena on a stretcher. Deeply concerned, Goldust would do CPR, and it worked. Good times. I'm not too sure why Vince McMahon called the life-saving moment revolting, or why Johnson looked like he wanted to kill a man when he woke up and realized he had gold paint on his lips. The pair should be grateful. Goldust saved a man's life and spared Vince McMahon of yet another mainstream media inquest. I guess it's important to mention here that Johnson, in one of those shoot interviews, claimed that he and Goldust agreed the CPR would be applied, with Goldie's hands separating their lips like they do in the movies. However, with the live TV cameras rolling, our boy went lip to lip and there was nothing Ahmed could do but just lay back and enjoy the experience. Hey, what's he like, the little scamp? Number 1, the moment he told Vince McMahon he was willing to get breast implants. We all know that Vince McMahon won't ask his superstars to do something that he wouldn't. The billionaire pissed himself on national television, for crying out loud. So imagine then when one of his most committed employees approached him and said, "Hey boss, what if I got breast implants to make my character even more of a freak?" Imagine Vince McMahon sitting back and thinking, "Would I get breast implants myself, making it fair to ask one of my guys to do so? Would I sacrifice these pecs for a pair of breasts? Hell no I wouldn't, Dustin, get out of my office." We're forever hearing about crazy plans that almost happened, with some sounding more far-fetched than others. This is one of those that was true, with Vince Russo of all people backing up the claims in his book. If you don't believe him, however, Bruce Pritchard also claims it's true because, and I quote, "there had been some guy that had gotten breast implants and there was a lot to do about it," apparently. Apparently our Dustin pitched the idea to everyone around Vince before going to see the boss one-on-one. He really wanted to get the breast implants, get double D's and stuff, Pritchard said, but thank God Vince McMahon talked him out of it. We know it's wrong on all sorts of levels, but seeing it might have been interesting. Maybe the fumes from the epoxy floor paint for medium traffic areas that I've been applying to my face and balls for the last month have finally messed with my sanity. Probably. So that's our list. Let us know what you think in the comments below, and you can follow me on Twitter here. If you enjoy what we do at Cultaholic, you can pledge to our Patreon. That's patreon.com/cultaholic. And most importantly, don't forget to hit subscribe and join us.